で、私はこの慰安婦問題については相当研究してきたつもりで、で、特に一番大きいなと思ったのはですね、このラムゼイ先生の研究にも関係あるんですけど、日本軍はですね、当初、その業者を使ってね、で、業者が女性を集めるということをやったんですね。これで1932年の事件があるんですけど、上海に海軍指定慰安所というのを作って、で、それでそこにですね、業者が日本から女性を連れて行って慰安婦にしたという事件があるんですね。で、これがですね、実はちゃんと、まあ、紙になってるかどうかわかりませんけど、契約があるんですよ。ね、その契約ったって合意でしょ？で、長崎の女性にですね、上海に行って喫茶店に勤めたらたくさん給料あげるよとかね、食堂で給仕をやればこれはたくさん、お金あげるよっていう、そういうような合意ですよね。だから合意があって女性は行ってるわけです。長崎に。いや、から上海にね。だけど上海に行ってみたら、実はそこは海軍の慰安所だったと。だけどこれをね、そのお金払ったんだからいいじゃないかとか、あるいは合意があるからいいんじゃないかって言ってもね、それは違うんですよね。その性的なサービスをするんだっていう合意をね、きちんとしてるのかっていうことで、実はしてなかったわけですよ。で、日本人女性たちがたくさんそうやって連れて行かれた。これ騙されたもんですから、日本の刑法で言うと、当時でもですね、誘拐になるんですね。海外への誘拐です。だからそれで長崎の検察庁がきちんと起訴をして、で、長崎地方裁判所が業者10人ぐらい、その実刑を含む重罪で処罰したんですね。で、この判決が長崎高訴院大審院というふうに行きまして、確定してるんですよ。で、海軍の指定慰安所っていうのがこんなもんだったんだっていうことは、当時はそれで日本に知られた。そして、それが違法なやり方をしてたんだっていうことで処罰もされた。で、それで辞めればよかったんですよね、海軍はね、陸軍も。だけど、そうじゃなくて、今度は捕まらないように上手にやろうということで、日本の内地だとね、今、長崎みたいにこう捕まっちゃうから、で、韓国、朝鮮の方に行ってですね、同じようなことをやった。だから、朝鮮の女性たちの証言を聞くと、この海軍の指定慰安所の、今の事件を私は、その判決をね、発掘して、研究して、これ英語でも2004年に発表してるんですけど、それそっくり同じことをね、朝鮮でやった。で、朝鮮の方ではですね、内地のような取り締まりは厳しくないんですよ。だから総督が軍人ですから。それで、朝鮮では本当にそっくりこの判決の内容の通りのことがされたわけですね。だから、無理やりに連れてったかどうかっていうことよりも、この騙してね、連れていくという場合が非常に多かったんですね。だから、やっぱり私はこの長崎地方裁判所の検察、をきちんと研究しなきゃいけない。から、それでその軍の方の慰安所についてはですね、いわゆる日本の内地や、朝鮮にあって交渉制というね、法規があって、将棋取締規則とかね、そういうような規則がきちんとあって、警察もきちんと関与して、まあ、いわゆる管理売春ですけど、そういったようなことじゃなくて、全く法令を作らなかったんですね。秘密制度にしたわけですよ。ラムゼイ先生に対して私は言いたいのは、そういうですね、合意があったとか、ちゃんとお金を払ったからいいじゃないかっていうんじゃなくて、実態をきちんと研究しなきゃいけないんじゃないかと。それからこの法令がなかったっていうね、海軍指定慰安所についてはですね、軍の法令を作れたんですよ。だけど作らなかった。陸軍の方も作らなかった。これはですね、この判決があって、違法だと、やり方がね、違法だということになっちゃうから、むしろ秘密制度にして実施するという、そっちへ行っちゃった。だからこれはですね、私は日本の陸軍、海軍の間違いだったと。国際条約にも違反するし、国内法にも違反することをね、闇でやってしまった。そういうようなことを私は研究をいたしました。
When I first read the article, I thought this is a law school article. This is the way lawyers look at things. I think law school trains lawyers to be advocates for a client. They're not out to find the truth. I feel in my field, history, you're trying to find the truth about something. But in law school, you're learning how to be an advocate, how to protect your client. And it looked to me like this was a pure advocacy piece and that Professor Ramseur was trying to defend the Japanese government. And so it didn't seem to me like an honest piece at all. It seemed to me like he was in the courtroom arguing before a judge saying, here are the facts, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and trying to impress the judge with a set of facts that may or may not be part of the truth. And you know how they say, if you can get a good lawyer, he can argue anything. And lawyers are trained to argue without their own personal bias. You take one side one time, you can take another side the next time. And what you do is you argue that case, irrespective of the truth. And that's what he seemed to be doing, is to be arguing a case.
A lot of the Japanese thought that, oh, look at him, he's Japanese, but he's criticizing us. Well, he's not Korean. He's Japanese American. He has no business talking about what happened in Asia. And some of my own people here in this country used to criticize me too, saying, are you not proud of being Japanese? And why are you doing this? And here's the answer very quickly. Number one, our own government put the Japanese Americans into camp, concentration camp, after February 19, 1942, because we look like the enemy. We look like the Japanese enemy in the 1940s. So based on fear, war hysteria, and a failure of political leadership in this country in the 1940s, they passed executive orders, they passed laws to make sure that our community was removed from our homes and put into concentration camps in this country, 10 of them. And so our country took away our rights, took away our due process, destroyed our civil liberties, destroyed our personal lives, took us out of our homes. People lost their homes, lost their property, lost everything that they worked for at least a generation and a half. And so in 1988, after over 50 years, our community decided to organize and decide to go after the U.S. government for an apology and reparations. And so in 1988, after 10 years of working in Congress, we finally got a signed law, a legal apology from the United States government, signed by President Reagan. And it's a bill and it's legal. And it's history now in saying that what the U.S. government did to us, its own citizens, was wrong. It was based upon racial prejudice, war hysteria, and a failure of political leadership. And this is what happened with Japan in Asia. The Japanese government systematically captured, kidnapped girls and women to become sexual slaves in the comfort stations in the war front in Asia. So that was a violation of human rights. It was a violation against women. It was human trafficking. And all those things were international laws, and the Japanese government have broken it. And they captured at least 200,000 to 300,000 girls and women throughout Asia and subjected them to sexual slavery. And that was wrong. And so in 1992, three of them went to court in Japan, and the courts in Japan said that you're right, we did this. The courts acknowledged it, but did not say that you have a remedy. You should get an apology. The government took that under Cabinet Secretary Kono, and he studied it and said it was a terrible thing that we did as a military, and we should apologize and provide reparations. Well, that was a good thing for him to say, but it was not legal. It was not accepted by the legal body of the Japanese government. And so that's why I'm involved, is because I believe that the government did wrong against these girls and women, and they deserve, as the victims, in a full legal apology that's clear and unambiguous, and then also accept the historical responsibility of doing it. And then the third step is to teach the children the truth so it won't happen again. And so I'm involved because it happened to my community. I was 1 year old when it happened. But when I became a young adult, I realized what my government did to us and had to work to extract an apology from our government. This is what I'm saying, that the Korean-American diaspora in this country, we have to work to make sure our government tells the Japanese government, do the right thing, become a mature democratic country. And when you make that apology, we can work together as trusted neighbors, as trusted partners. And we could forgive, but we won't forget.
News를 듣는 순간 저는 먼저 피해자 할머니들이 생각났습니다. 램지어 교수의 주장은 진실이 아니고 또 사실을 왜곡할 뿐 아니라 역겨운 정말 발언들이었거든요. 우리는 인신매매와 성착취를 당한 피해자들의 권익을 찾아주려고 노력해야 되는데 그러기는커녕 오히려 그분들에게 더 큰 상처를 주는 일이 없어야 된다고 생각했기 때문에 그 뉴스를 듣는 순간 램지어 교수에게 사과를 촉구하는 스테이트먼트를 낸 것입니다.
저 연판장에서도 이제 보시면은 항문의 자위에 대한 얘기를 그 구체적으로 얘기를 하고 있거든요. 특히 마지막에서 우리가 이거를 항문의 자유를 구속하려는 목적이 아니다. 항문의 자유는 당연히 인정이 돼야죠. 예를 들어서 뭐 하버드에서 얘기하는 다수의 의견을 존중하기 위해서 소수의 의견이 무시되어서는 안 된다. 그것도 저는 동의를 합니다. 그런데 문제는 항문의 자유라 하더라도 리밋이 있는 거잖아요. 그렇죠? 그래서 특히 대표적인 예로 남의 거를 베껴썼다든지 plagiarism 아니면은 뭐 내가 딴 데 출판했던 것을 여기다 똑같이 출판을 한다든지 아니면은 있지도 않는 데이터를 가지고 만들어낸다든지 그런 면에서는 학문의 자유가 존중될 수가 없죠. 아무리 학문의 자유를 우리가 존중을 한다 하더라도 그런 리미테이션은 확실히 있다고 보고요. 적어도 제 생각에는 저희 생각에서는 이런 논문 자체가 그런 리밋을 넘은 게 아닌가 그렇게 생각하고 있습니다.
例えばこのラムセア先生のね、論文の場合ですけど、そういう日本の歴史家の方々の研究、大変立派な研究たくさんあるんですよ。そういったものをですね、本当はね、そういうこう、先行研究っていうんですかね、これは何語であっても全部こう参照して、その上でこの論文を書いていただくという必要があるわけですよ。ところがラムゼア先生の場合にはですね、私たちの研究、ね、についてはあるいは日本の歴史家の先生方の研究については視野に入ってない。この先行研究っていうのをですね、一応全部こう見た上でその研究をしなきゃいけない。これがあの学問的な鉄則なんですけど、それがラムゼア先生の場合はできてなかった。だからそこに学問的な問題があるんですね。で、それで、その、例えばそういうことをですね、ハーバード大学のその学術雑誌がですね、事前に審査をして、で、これは出版にふさわしいかどうかということを、その、通常はですね、あの、審査する手続きがあるんですね。その手続きにパスしたということなんでしょうけど、そうだとするとですね、ハーバード大学のその審査の手続きが非常にあの、こう、なんていうんですかね、甘かった。そうすると、この倫理的な面で どうなのかとかね、学問的な水準で言って、これは十分なのかとかいうようなことが検討されないままですね、どんどん論文が発表されちゃってるということになるわけでしょ。そうするとね、ハーバード大学自身のこの名声に傷つきますよ。よね。
When I spoke earlier about the Holocaust, I said the Holocaust was worse because there were more people involved. But it's the same kind of thing. It's a war crime, and it's a violation of human rights on multiple levels. So it was unquestionably a war crime, and Japan purposely substituted comfort stations, a war crime, for the massacre of Nanjing, another war crime.
굉장히 이제 복잡한 이슈가 있을 것 같은데요. 뭐 저는 역사학자가 아니지만 뭐 제가 생각에는 제가 알고 있는 역사적으로 잠깐 말씀을 드리자면 뭐 이런 여러 가지 이유가 있을 것 같네요. 첫째는 2차 세계대전이 끝나고 유태인 학살에 대해서는 유럽에서는 예를 들어서 recognition이라든지 accountability에 대한 프로세스가 굉장히 많았거든요. 대표적으로 말씀을 드리면 뭐 Nuremberg Trial이라든지 그런 재판을 통해 가지고 유대인 학살을 이제 가담하든지 뭐 리드를 했던 사람들한테 굉장히 그런 accountability 이슈를 했는데 아시아 쪽에서는 그런 게 상당히 부족했던 것 같습니다. 물론 도쿄 트라이얼이 있기는 했지만 전범자 그 탑에 대해서만 accountability가 이슈가 됐고 또 하필이면 그 당시에 다 한국도 그렇고 중국도 그렇고 Civil War에 이제 들어가는 바람에 유럽처럼 좀 더 액티브한 그 스탠스를 취하지 못했고 그거부터 이제 시작해서 여러 해 동안 일본 정부에서 그거를 이제 부정한다든지 그리고 한국 정부라 중국 정부에서도 크게 더 이슈화하지 않았던 점 그런 점들에 대해서 뭐 여러 가지가 있을 수 있을 것 같습니다.
So I think Korean history is really poorly taught. That's the biggest problem. And it is on par with what the Nazis did to the Jewish people. And I think the atrocities in Korea started long before what happened in Germany. And so I don't know why this issue isn't settled. And especially from people like Harvard, they claim they're the best scholars and the top university in the world. Why can't they settle this? But it goes back to being pro-Japanese in some situations.
Well, that is because in the early history of Korea, in the 1800s, they had chose isolation. So consequently, foreign relations was very lacking for the Korean government. And so they were never able to get their story out. Again, it goes back to our lack of communicating with the international community in the late 1800s and the early 1900s.
저 같은 경우는 아미니안 제노사이드를 커머메이트 했었는데요. 그때마다 제가 터키 가버먼트에서 편지를 받았어요. 처음엔 데드레트도 받고 자기네가 숨기기 위해서 그리고 150만 명이 죽지 않았다. 한 명이 죽었어도 이거는 말도 안 되는 소리잖아요. 또 주위시들이 그 당한 일들. 그거는 이제부터 이런 헤이트 크라임이라든지 이런 역사가 또 잘못돼서 사람을 죽인다든지 이런 거는 절대로 우리 아이들 우리 자손들은 반복해서는 안 된다고 생각하기 때문에 역사는 정확하게 짚고 넘어가야 된다고 생각해요.
And a few years ago also we had a comfort woman who came and spoke at the museum. But I have to say that that event also shocked me because we wanted that event to enlighten people. And what I felt took place that evening was enraging people. Especially younger Korean Americans walked out so angry and, you know, pointing fingers at today's Japanese people. I don't see that either as the way forward. So, but even this old man knows about K-pop and the controversies involving the most, you know, powerful K-pop group some years ago, involving their insensitivities and usage of Nazi imagery. And more recently, the singer Soan from K-Friend, who embraced a mannequin of a Nazi soldier in full uniform. So as a person who's involved in the whole issue of memory and trying to encourage younger generations to learn from the past, you have to educate the younger generations to understand what transpired. People don't walk out of the Museum of Tolerance hating Germans. People walk out of the Museum of Tolerance saying, that was a horrible era. People made horrific decisions and needed to take personal responsibility and not say they were just following orders. And I think I'm learning some basic lessons about personal responsibility and critical thinking so I don't automatically believe everything a government tells me.
사실 이 위안부 문제는 홀로코스트와 같은 인류 보편적인 인권 문제라는 거를 우리가 먼저 인식을 해야 합니다. 사실 우리 할머니들이 가장 큰 피해를 당하셨기 때문에 우리는 이 문제를 자꾸 한국인의 문제로 생각하기 쉬운데요. 사실 그것보다는 특히 미국에서 살아가고 있는 우리 한인 커뮤니티, 우리 한인 차세대들은 미국에서 전 학교에서 홀로코스트에 대해서 배우는 이 현상을 보면서 우리가 배울 점이 있다고 생각합니다. 사실 이 홀로코스트 같은 것도 저절로 이루어진 일이 아니죠. 유태인들이 끊임없이 이 문제를 가지고 문제 제기를 하고 정치권을 압박하고 교육계와 문화예술계에서 계속해서 이슈화를 하고 떠들고 또 주장을 해왔기 때문에 홀로코스트가 세계 인권 문제로서 이렇게 이만큼 정착을 한 것이거든요. 위안부 문제도 마찬가지라고 생각합니다. 2016년도에 캘리포니아 교과서 고등학교 세계사 교과 과정에 위안부 문제가 포함이 됐습니다. 그랬을 때 가장 큰 피해를 입은 우리 아시아 커뮤니티로서 많은 분들이 아 우리 학생들이 이 위안부 문제에 대해서 어떻게 생각하는가 궁금해할 것이고요. 우리 한인 커뮤니티에 또 궁금해할 건데요. 그럴 때 우리가 이 문제에 대해서 잘 알고 있어야 하고 또 나머지 타 인종 커뮤니티에서도 이 문제에 대해서 제대로 인식을 하도록 도움을 주는 그런 역할을 해야 한다는 것이죠. 그래서 타주에서도 이제 캘리포니아가 가장 선도적으로 위안부 문제를 교과 과정에 포함시켰지만 아직도 49개 주가 남아있지 않습니까? 그래서 타주에서도 위안부 문제를 이 공립학교 교과 과정에 포함시킬 수 있도록 우리 한인 커뮤니티가 나서서 타인종 커뮤니티와 협력을 해서 인류 보편적인 인권 문제로서 인식되고 정착되고 교육될 수 있도록 적극적인 역할을 펼쳐야 한다고 생각하고요. 그런 과정에서 우리 차세대들의 역할이 매우 중요하다고 하겠습니다.